Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Above Average Baseball Show with your host. That's me, the King Source. Now, we're going to get into all things baseball, but as that red button says, please subscribe to the channel, like the videos, and watch them all the way through. It really does help out my channel and all the sports-related channels. Now, let's talk about pitching injuries first. This is the big subject on baseball right now. You could see right in there, 350% increased risk of injury. Now, saying greater than 100 pitchers per year. That's less than 100 pitchers per year, actually, is what he's saying there. That's what it looks like. It's associated with 350% risk of injury. Now, in youth arms, by the way. Youth arms are different than the full arms, like a full-grown man's arms. And this is one thing most people don't understand. A kid 10 to 18 cannot just go out throwing pitches the way a full-grown 20-plus-year-old adult can. The muscles and ligaments in the elbow are not fully developed. The man muscles are not fully developed into a boy yet. That happens around the age 14 to 16, and it's not even completed till 18. So there's a lot of mitigating factors in here. But yeah, if you're not yet 18, you should not be throwing over 100 pitches. However, what's going on in the MLB right now? We are setting record numbers for Tommy John surgeries and other pitching injuries. We are 131 of them since March 1st. This has never happened before. The previous record was under 50. It's as alarming as it gets. And what is embarrassing is the way the MLB is acting about it. Now, the MLB and MLBPA both released statements on it. Okay? I'm going to read these statements for you and give you my thoughts on them. So I got to scroll back and find them. And it's quite interesting because they're both wrong. They're both partially right, but both wrong. Okay, first let's get the MLBPA's statement. Now, I've retweeted them days ago, so you can go find them if you'd want. And, man, I'm not seeing the MLBPA statement. I might have to try to pull that up a different way. You need the MLBPA win first. Trying to figure out their statement. Oh, man. Oh, right there. I believe, yes. Regarding pitching injuries from the MLBPA. This is from Director Tony Clark, by the way. Despite unanimous player opposition and significant concerns regarding health and safety, the commissioner's office reduced the length of the pitch clock last December, just one season removed from imposing the most significant rule change in decades. Since then, our concerns about the health and impacts of reduced recovery time have only intensified. The league's unwillingness, thus, to acknowledge the study the effects of these unprofound changes is an unprecedented threat to our game and its most valuable asset, the players. That's actually a really good statement. Great statement from Tony Clark. The pitch clock was never tested in minor leagues to see the effects it would have. These pitchers are not used to having to gear up every 20 seconds. It's not normal as is throwing overhand. So why are we forcing them to do this? MLB responded to this, and this is BS. Straight up lies defending their brain-dead rule change, okay? Straight up lies. Quote, Major League Baseball statement. This statement ignores the empirical evidence, and that is the MLBPA statement, and much more significant long-term trend over multiple decades of velocity and spin increases that are highly correlated with arm injuries. Nobody wants to see pitchers get hurt in this game. MLB is currently undergoing significant comprehensive research study into the causes of this long-term increase, interviewing prominent medical experts across baseball, which to date has been consistent with the independent analysis by Johns Hopkins University, have found no evidence to support introduction of pitch clock has increased injuries. I'm going to pause because that's an out-and-out lie. There is a direct correlation. Look before the 2023 season, they averaged about 25 pitching injuries a year. The 2023 season had over 150. The 2024 season is on pace for over 300. There is evidence backing up the fact that the pitch clock is causing injuries. Emphatic, provable evidence. That's an out-and-out lie by MLB to defend their rule change. Okay? BS to the hilt. Okay? Johns Hopkins University never did an analysis. They came out with a statement saying such, by the way. That's all I could say on it because of probable lawsuits going to happen here over legalities. So, yeah. In fact, and we'll get back to the quote now. In fact, Johns Hopkins University found no evidence pitchers who worked quickly in 2023 were more likely to sustain an injury than those who worked less quickly on average. Johns Hopkins also found no evidence that pitchers who sped up their pace were likely to sustain an injury than those who did not. Again, unabated out-and-out lies. That's what this is. There is evidence. And now I want to go back and talk about something they said. Decades of pitching speed and torque? It's not decades. It's brand new. They've only been doing it since 2010 with the foreign substances, spin rate addiction, and as fast as you can throw addictions. They are new, 2010 or after. So this is the most BS statement I have ever heard from the MLB. It is provable fact the pitch clock is causing injuries, but it's also provable fact, yes, the foreign substance abuse and the all-out addiction to pitch speed, getting as fast a fastball as you can, is. You look prior to 2010. There were five total pitchers in baseball that could top 95 miles an hour. Three were on the Yankees. C.C. Sabathia, Gilbert Chamberlain, and that lefty, what's his name? Demas Amarte. And he'd only get about 97, 98. The sheer fact almost all pitchers can hit 100 miles an hour now, yes, that is part of the issue. Straight up fact, that's part of the issue. But to say the pitch clock is not having an effect is the biggest out-and-out lie ever. I will be stunned if the MLBPA doesn't file a lawsuit against the MLB to force out the pitch clock now. Stunned after this BS statement. They are leaving the MLBPA with no choice. Because you look before the pitch clock, again, they only average 25 pitching injuries a year, all time. All of a sudden in 2023, over 150 of them, I think it's 153. And this year on pace for 300. It is the pitch clock causing it. Yes, if you're having to do an unnatural motion faster and more often, it is going to cause injuries. The MLB is being irresponsible. And this blame thing back and forth, it's one of the dumbest things I've ever done. Another thing which a fan named Alex Hale posted on there, the difference in the baseball. Everybody, it was proven the MLB was lying about the differences in the baseball. So the MLB has no credibility and nothing to back their statement up with when it's provable fact the pitch clock is causing injuries, okay? Yes, velocity is part of the issue. But the pitch clock is the biggest issue. Okay? One of the issues that is one of the biggest ones, and that's where Eric Cressy comes in, with that statement is, babying pitchers is also to blame. There are so many different factors involved here. The pitch clock needs to be banned ASAP. That has to happen. Same with several things and rule changes in baseball, which I'm going to get into a little later. But also, we need to stop babying pitchers. Let them get to 120, 130 pitches a game. Stop yanking them out around 100, which is unnatural. You go back in baseball, and there was a time when pitching injuries almost never happened because pitchers weren't babied. The more pitchers being babied, the more injuries coming up. And yes, the pitch clock is part of this. The pitch clock must be banned. Foreign substances must be banned permanently. This addiction to fastball speed and getting 100 miles an hour must be banned. Teach these guys how to pitch, not just throw a fast fastball. There are so many factors involved here. And yes, the MLBPA was a little bit wrong with their statement. Yes, it is what the MLB was saying partially. To me, it's about 80% to blame on the pitch clock. Then the other 20% is all these other factors. It might even be as low as 50% on the pitch clock, but it's no lower than 50%. The pitch clock has to go, no matter what. So the whole focus around pitching in baseball is wrong. It is wrong. And a big factor is quality starts so far. The Kansas City Royals have 8. No other team has more than 5. And two of those teams with 5, the O's and the Rays are straight up cheating to get there. It is known fact they're cheating with their pitching. Same with the Red Sox. And same with the Blue Jays. Every team in the East is cheating to catch the Yankees. And it's not just them. But after that, you have the Red Sox at 4. That's literally impossible. Red Sox don't have the pitching staff to have any quality starts. Same as the Cheaters are at 4. The Pirates being at 4 is a little fishy. Giants being at 4 is impossible. There's more cheating. The White Sox being at 4 is BS cheating. So you can see teams are using foreign substances. This is proof of it. And I've retweeted this as well. You can go check this quality start thing. Then you go down. The Yankees only have 2. The Yankees have the pitchers to have had at least 5 by now. Are you kidding me? The Braves only have one? What? With the Braves staff, the Cubs only have two of their staff? The Nationals have none, which is a little surprising because they have a couple pitchers that can do it. This graph shows the issue in baseball and the cheating in baseball. So if I was going to attack the pitching issues, the first thing I do is ban the pitch clock and pace of play. I ban both of them permanently. I make it so they can never be brought back. Second, I then ban foreign substance completely and say any pitcher caught with anything on the mound other than the baseball and his glove, automatic ejection and suspension the rest of the year. If it's caught a second time, they're banned for life. Okay? You have to attack it where the issue exists. Not just blame cast back and forth spouting provable out-and-out lies as MLB did. MLB has no credibility left. Rob Manfred has to go ASAP, get a commission in there who liked old-fashioned baseball, and will fix baseball. Now, getting to the rules. I put something up earlier today stating the most broken, rigged rules in baseball, okay? Here's the list. The MLB's brain-dead CBT, that's the luxury tax, which should be illegal. It is literal communist crap. Spreading the wealth. You go to the CBT and these small market teams will be forced to spend again, and you'll see parity. Number two, MLB's brain-dead pitch clock. I already talked about that. Number three, MLB's brain-dead pace of play. Already talked about that. Number four, the NCAA's targeting rule. That is one of the more broken rules. Number four, MLB's brain-dead arbitration BS. Three or four of the top five are baseball rules. They're the most broken rules. Another one having to do with baseball is pro sports not having an equal 32 teams and 16 playoff teams with 8 in each league or conference. All pro sports should have 32 teams and 8 playoff teams on each side, so half the teams getting in. That's the only way the sports can equal out, and you're going to have parity in the sports. And even for each sport to have parity within the leagues and conferences, okay? You can't be having bias in pro sports. There's no excuse for NFL not have 8 on each side. No excuse. Now, with the MLB, there's just so much broken about the MLB that I don't know how you fix it. It's that broken, okay? Now, as I do every week during the season, let's take a look at the standings in the MLB, and I'm going to show you some of this cheating. We'll start with the NL West. We're going to go NL West all the way up to AL East. Dodgers lead 8-4, 3 games ahead of the Padres here, 5-7. Okay, that's exactly as I predicted. The Diamondbacks, yep. Then the Giants, then the Rockies at the exact order it should be in. So no big surprises there. Then we get the surprise. Pirates 8-2. They're not good enough. They're good enough right now to be about 5-5 to 6-4. I'll be honest. They're going to be right around or just above it. By the way, the Yankees just signed left-hand pitcher Josh Mazejewski and selected him after roster Jake Cousins is gone. They opted Cousins to DFA Clayton Andrews, actually. So another left-hand pitcher of the Yankees, if he's any better than what they've had. They're getting back. Since any of the Brewers 6-2, they're not good enough. No, not Corbin Burns. They're good enough to be about, what, 4-4? Another thing I hate about baseball is you have all these different amount of games played. I don't know why that's so broken either. Then you have the Cubs 6-3. Yeah, that's right where they should be. Reds 5-4. Then the Cardinals 5-5. Cardinals should be about 4-6. So they're a little better than they should be. That division's not going to have everybody above 500, okay? By the end of the season, at least two of the teams should be under 500. The Cubs won't be. The Cubs should be the team that ends up winning that division. NL West, you have the Braves at 6-2, and I told you teams are better than it was looking. Phillies 4-5, they've closed the gap down. This is 2.5 games from the, what was it, 4.5 last week. Then you have the Mets 3-6, and Nationals at 3-6, and then the Marlins 1-9. That's about where it should be. Marlins about to get the butts kicked, by the way, in the Bronx. Yankees going to slap around the next three games. So, let's look at the NL. Let's look at the AL West 6-3 Rangers. Somehow have just a one-game lead over the BS cheating Angels. Angels are above 500. They're not good enough to be. They played 9 games. They should be 3-6. Yeah. Then you have the Mariners 4-6. They should be 5-5. Just more of this BS. Then the Cheatsters at 3-7. They should be about 1-9. Oakland Athletics at 3-7. Okay, that's a little, might be a little better than they should be, but that's about right around where they should have been. In the Central, Guardians 7-2. They're not good enough to be. They're going to be 5-4. Tigers 6-3, not good enough to be. Again, they should be about 5-4. Royals 6-4, surprise. I told you they'd be good. I'm a surprise by that, though. I've picked them to win about 88 games. That's about the pace they're on. That'd be 140, by the way, if you're good at math. 6-4, 140. 100 wins, 40 losses. Or not 40 losses, 60 losses, if I can say it. Because, anyways, it's just the math. Twins 3-4, okay. White Sox 1-8, okay. Twins being 0-2 is a little suspicious. I'll throw that one out. 0-2 at home, I should say. We'll get to more BS cheating in a second. But the White Sox 1-8, they should be a little better than that. Let's go look at the AL East. Yankees lead 8-2. That's expected. And then here's some of the biggest cheating in baseball. The Red Sox are 7-3. That is literally impossible. They don't have the hitters or pitching staff be better than 3-7. Straight up BS cheating there by the Red Sox. Baltimore Orioles 5-4. Okay, that's about where they should be, but they cheated to win a game, so they should be 4-5. They straight up cheated to win a game. Tampa Bay Rays 5-5, straight up cheating. They're not going to be better than 3-7. They straight up cheated to win two games. Now going back to the Red Sox, all 10 of those games are on the road. The Red Sox aren't going to have to win, period, alone. 7-3 in a 10-game road trip. That's straight up BS. The Tampa Bay Rays 2-1 on the road. That's straight up BS. They should be 1-2 at best. Blue Jays 4-6, all 10 on the road. That's why, so they're about where they should be right now. But the Yankees are up top, and the Yankees play today. Red Sox don't, so that's going to go to game-and-a-half lead for the Yankees when they get to 9-2. So there's a look at your standings, and this has been the Above Average Baseball Show with your host. That is me, the King Source. Have a great day, everybody. Remember, the King Source loves you.